This is a prototype rotor for the world's smallest handmade electric motor. It's the largest component in the assembly, and I made it on a watchmaker's lathe. Here it is sitting on a grain of sand. So let's get cracking, and I will tell you about the motivation for this project. It was originally inspired by one of Richard Feynman's infamous lectures entitled "There's Plenty of Room at the Bottom." In this lecture, he offered a considerable cash prize to anyone who could make an electric motor no larger than 1/64 of an inch cubed. That's about the size of a grain of sand. He thought that this would require the invention of new manufacturing techniques, such as the lithography methods we use today for making computer chips. But a guy called William McLellan decided to take on the challenge. Toiling away on his lunch breaks, he managed to make the motor by hand, armed with only basic tools. This was a truly groundbreaking achievement, and to my knowledge, nobody else has managed to replicate this. So the question is, using similar tools and techniques, can we achieve the same feat? To stand a chance of making a motor at this scale, it has to be very simple. The idea here is four electromagnets are attached to a base plate, and the rotor sits between the electromagnets. By energizing diagonal pairs of coils with opposite polarities, the hope is we can rotate the magnetized rotor. My wife Hazel is going to build the drive circuitry using digital electronics, but I imagine McLellan used analog electronics for his motor. During the course of this video, I think it's important to remember just how small this motor is. I've filmed most of the footage through a microscope, so it's easy to forget. For example, the rotor shaft is 90 microns in diameter, which is about the diameter of a human hair. This makes it very easy to buckle, break, or even squash by just measuring it. Now, to avoid this problem, I drilled a 0.1mm hole in a piece of brass to use as a gauge. To part off the finished component, I ground a micro parting tool. But here you can see a problem. The parting tool left a small pip in the center of the test component. This is normal, but at this scale I don't have the option to turn the part around to face it off, which is the normal procedure. So I decided to try this circular saw, but without space to get a tailstock in to catch the cut-off part, it just vanished into thin air, and not into the beaker as I'd hoped. I tried using a hypodermic syringe to feed in a droplet of alcohol, and the surface tension of the liquid was enough to catch the part, but then I realized the annoying pip was still there anyway. At this point, I decided to throw money at the problem with these electroformed diamond dicing blades used to cut silicon. They are super thin and fine, so I thought would do the trick. To be honest, I wasn't a fan of catching the part in the droplet because the droplet was consumed by the rotating blade and part. And because of this, I was required to continually feed in the syringe at the right rate to form a stable droplet, whilst at the same time feed the blade in at the correct rate to not overheat or break, since these blades are ridiculously fragile when they're used in completely the wrong material and machine, like I'm attempting to do here. This turned out to be too much to handle, and after multiple blade failures I had to give up on this approach. I thought it was time to revisit basic principles and went back to the parting tool, but I tried grinding different geometries until I managed to achieve one that actually worked. At this point, it felt like I'd finally nailed it. With my carefully ground parting tool and a hypodermic needle in the tailstock chuck to help support the part, I managed to produce something I was finally happy with. Now, it wasn't until the test run that I realized this was all a giant waste of time, but I'll get onto that later. For now, let's have a look at how I made the electromagnets. Fundamentally, the electromagnets are made by winding wire around a soft ferromagnetic material. After the practice I had at machining small diameters with the rotor, making the electromagnet cores was actually a pretty easy job. The challenge was winding the coils. Remember, you're looking at a magnified image, but the truth is this wire is about 5 times thinner than a human hair, and as such I couldn't see it by eye. Nevertheless, since I'm an optimistic person, I thought I would start by trying to wind by hand. As you probably predicted straight away, this was just not possible. As you can see here, it was not only too difficult to manipulate the wire, but it was also very easy to break. To overcome this challenge, I began with making a brass bushing to guide the wire, but I also needed a way to swing the other end of the wire around the electromagnet core whilst providing clearance with the wire travelling through the bushing. To do this, I screwed on the catch plate with a custom peg to provide an attachment point for the wire. I then mounted the spool on a secondary tool post. I made a felt spool core which provided a small amount of resistance which is required for the winding process. After that, it was just a matter of turning the spindle by hand with the wire taped to the catch plate, and this worked really well, until I got to the end of the core and had to lay on another layer of wire on top of the previous one. You can see I attempted this with tweezers, but I was worried I had damaged the wire. So I devised a much better approach. With the rod in the tailstock, I could ensure the first layer of wire was flush with the end of the core. I then applied a tiny amount of low viscosity cyanoacrylate adhesive, basically superglue, with a toothpick before using a hypodermic needle with a flat ground end to push the wire over the top of the first layer. I cut the core off with the tip of some super fine cutters, and because the wire was still taped to the catch plate, I didn't have to worry about losing the part. With just one more part left to make, I was starting to think this might be possible. I made the base plate from brass rod to hold all the parts together, and I left the base attached to the rod so I could handle the motor. I drilled four 0.1mm holes and put a small indentation in the centre to help guide the rotor shaft. Now the assembly process caused some headaches. I placed the electromagnets in the holes with the toothpick, but debris from the toothpick was causing issues, and attempting to clean this with a toothbrush just made it worse, so I just did my best to work around it. This is the bulk of the motor next to my index finger for scale. To hold the electromagnets in position and help protect the fragile wires at the same time, I used a dab of the same low viscosity glue I used earlier. When I tried applying the droplet, it annoyingly engulfed the coils and then dried before I had the chance to wick up the excess. I was about to start the project again, but in a last-ditch attempt to salvage the situation, I tried cleaning out the centre with a 0.1mm drill bit just held in my fingers, and I couldn't believe my luck when this appeared to work. I haven't put the rotor in yet because we first need to build the fixture for holding the motor upright and the custom PCB to allow us to connect it to Hazel's drive circuitry. To make the PCB, I used the pantograph. This is essentially a milling machine, but I can force the spindle to follow any 2D pathway using a template. The PCB consists of a hole in the middle for the motor to poke through, and four pairs of pads that I can solder the coil wires to. I found soldering this wire a bit of a challenge because the wire itself tended to melt, but when I soldered directly to the PCB, it was fine. With the motor connected, I just had to mark the rotor so we could see it spin under the microscope, magnetize it with this Heath Robinson rotating magnet setup, and place it in the center of the motor. I don't want to say how many rotors I lost during this phase, it's just embarrassing, and needless to say, once it had pinged out the tweezers, there's absolutely no point in trying to find the part. I couldn't breathe during the operation because my hands wouldn't be stable enough, but I can only comfortably hold my breath for 40 seconds or so, which wasn't enough time to safely transfer the rotor from the work surface to the motor. I did invest in these surprisingly expensive special fine-tip tweezers, just so I could even pick the rotor up, which did help a lot, and I did finally get one to work. So let's turn it on. Here you can see the wires are wobbling at the frequency of the electrical signal, which is a promising start, but unfortunately the rotor showed no signs of moving. By this point I'd invested several months into this ridiculous project, so I wasn't about to give up now. I did some experiments on the rotor after the test run, and realised the rotor had lost its magnetism. In a way though, this was actually good news, because this implied that the electromagnets were working, and their magnetic field was overwriting the field I applied with the neodymium magnets earlier. My brother Charlie, who's an expert on magnets, suggested I use a material called Alnico. I could only source this pre-magnetized, so I bought a piece and heated it up beyond what's called the Curie temperature, and then I let it cool down slowly to demagnetize it. At this point, I assumed it would just be a matter of repeating the process from before, but it turns out this material is just not machinable. You can see here it's been mangled and my tooltip has been destroyed. So I set up a grinding wheel in the lathe and used what was left of those electroformed diamond blades to grind the rotor shape. But now I couldn't use my special parting tool from earlier, so I had no way to cut it off. As before, the diamond wheel broke. So I decided to just try making a simple disc by reversing a chunk of the material in the collet and grinding away the excess, but it simply sheared off as soon as the grinding wheel made contact. Thankfully, the sheared piece remaining in the collet ended up being a disc of the correct size. To magnetise the new rotor, rather than using the silly rotating magnet setup earlier, Charlie pointed out I could just magnetise the rotor by touching it on an N52 grade neodymium magnet, and that's because the component is so small relative to the magnet, we can just assume the magnetic field is uniform near the magnet surface. Now obviously my Alnico disc doesn't have a shaft to hold it in place, so I placed a microscope cover slip, basically a thin piece of glass, over the electromagnets and applied a drop of watch oil. This allowed the Alnico disc to float on a thin film. I turned on the electromagnets and this is what I saw. Now, it's not exactly the eureka moment I was hoping for, but to be honest, for a while I thought it was going to be a lot worse. Now, when you include the thickness of the cover slip and the oil film, you could quite justifiably argue it no longer fits within the 0.4mm cube we originally targeted. So, I will be revisiting this project in the future with some new ideas. Let me know in the comments if you have any ideas what I can improve with version 2. Earlier in the video, I mentioned I applied cyanoacrylate to secure and protect the coils, but accidentally applied more than I intended. Under the optical microscope, it is difficult to see exactly how badly the excessive adhesive application affected the device because it's transparent to optical wavelengths. The good news is, the adhesive is opaque to electrons, which means we can use a scanning electron microscope to learn more for my next attempt. I just want to say here a special thanks to the Biomedical Imaging Unit at Southampton for kindly letting me use their microscope. Here is a scanning electron micrograph of the motor assembly next to a standard sewing needle eye for scale. You can see the coils are not very well defined because they're just engulfed by adhesive. If I zoom in, you can see the coil windings at the top, and you may also notice I accidentally broke one of the coil wires during sample prep. You can also now see all the debris generated by using a toothpick to manipulate the coils. Based on these images, I think it's clear that the adhesive has provided additional support for the fragile wires, but at the potential cost of increased friction on the rotor shaft. I think a bearing of some kind, like a watch jewel, might be called for in the next version, but I'm just not sure exactly how to implement one at this scale. So let me know in the comments if you have any ideas. So, having gone through this, I'm just blown away that McLellan managed to build this motor in just 2.5 months, and it's no wonder this project was considered pioneering in the field of nanotechnology at the time. If you are interested in learning more about this project and others, check out our Patreon page, links in the description. You can access an extra video on this project, as well as the CAD, drawing and Arduino code if you fancy having a crack at this challenge for yourself. And please do share any attempts, I would really love to see them. Thanks for watching, I will catch you in the next one.